Peace and love, Black family. It's the Prince of Pan-Africanism, Dr. Umar Johnson. We are live and direct, Norfolk, Virginia. Shout out to the seven cities of Norfolk, Suffolk, Chesapeake, Virginia Beach, and all the other seven cities. You know, I'm not going to remember all of them, but it's good to be back down here. Hampton, Newport News, it's good to be back down here in the Seven Cities community. This is Dr. Umar Johnson, the Prince of Pan-Africanism. And I know today is Super Bowl day, so I don't want to keep anyone too long because it is Super Bowl day. But what I would like to do is just talk briefly about addictions. As a therapist, I work with a lot of addicted populations. I have worked with a lot of our addicted populations. And being an addict, having an addiction can be a very, very traumatizing reality in someone's life. So I just want to distill today on this video, which shouldn't be more than an hour. I want to talk about addictions in Black people, and I want to give you some techniques for how to kick your addictions. We have all kinds of addictions. We have cigarette addictions, drinking addictions, snorting addictions, shopping addictions, sex addictions. There's all types of addictions that a person can suffer from. And when we talk about addiction, we're talking about a behavior that someone feels compelled to engage in order to compensate for something else that they're lacking in their life, or to replace or distract them from something that is going on in their life that they really don't feel motivated enough to confront and address head on once and for all. Okay, so yes, I'm wearing my Norfolk State sweater. This is the sweater that I purchased during last summer's Black College and Consciousness Tour. We visited Norfolk State University. At that time, I had no idea that Norfolk State University would be inviting the Prince of Pan-Africanism to campus for the first time to actually speak. So I will be speaking here tomorrow, Norfolk State University, historically Black college and university. Come on out and show love. We will be inside of the Wilder Center, W-I-L-D-E-R, the Wilder Center. And the doors open up at 5 o'clock. The program will start at 6 o'clock, and then the book signing and photo session will be from approximately 7:30 or 8 o'clock until we're done. I do have some I Am Nat Turner hoodies with me because Bowie State University really purchased a lot of the I Am Nat Turner hoodies. I don't have a lot, so you want to get there early tomorrow night if you want to get one of those I Am Nat Turner hoodies. Okay, so the event is free and it is open to the public. I repeat, the event tomorrow night at Norfolk State University is free and open to the public. And I want to give a shout out to Richmond, Virginia, because I will be in Richmond, Virginia next Wednesday, February the 15th, Richmond, Virginia, for the Gabriel Prosser Power Lecture, Richmond Stand Up. I haven't been to Richmond in years. I haven't been to Norfolk in about 2-3 years. I haven't been to Richmond in about 3-4 years. So really looking forward to getting back up to Richmond as well. So we got a back-to-back Virginia 2017 Black History Month Power Lecture. So Norfolk tomorrow, Monday, February the 6th. And then my very next lecture is in Richmond, Virginia, next Wednesday, February the 15th. So, let's talk about addictions. Now, first of all, I want to talk about the law of leverage. If you're suffering from an addiction, I want you to watch this. If you have someone in your family who you love who's dealing with an addiction, whether it's cocaine, cigarettes, drinking, sex, shopping, whatever the addiction is, relationships. Some of us have a relationship addiction, can't stand to be alone. Please make them watch this video. Please text them the link when we're done so they can watch the video. Okay? This is my wisdom, my approach, my philosophy, my theory based on my practice. Okay? Because I'm a scholar practitioner. I think and I act. I don't just think. I think and I act. So as a scholar practitioner, this is my distillation of addiction's wisdom for the black community. So I'm going to give you my laws. These are the Ten Commandments. Dr. Umar Johnson's Ten Commandments of Addiction. If you master these Ten Commandments of Addiction, you can conquer any addiction in your life. Whether it's people, substances, activities, it doesn't matter. Okay? So law number one is the law of leverage. Law number one is the law of leverage. Leverage means no one can kick an addiction. No one can break an addiction. No one can eliminate an addiction unless you have a personal reason. You must have a good enough personal reason to kick your addiction, or you will never kick your addiction. What I've noticed with people, brothers and sisters dealing with addictions, and most of us at some point of our life have dealt with an addiction or will deal with an addiction. So we're not talking about a small marginal population in the black community. All of us have had to deal with addictions on one level or another. Small addictions, strong addictions, but we've all had to, because we live in a society that creates addictions. America is based on what? Addiction to money. America is based on what? Addiction to pleasure. America is based on what? Addiction to power. Addiction to sex. So we live in a society, and I would probably even argue that we live in a world that is based on addictions. So all of us have had or will have to deal with an addiction at one point or another. That's not the problem. Can you kick your addiction? That's what we want to talk about today. Can you kick your addiction? Can you knock it off? Knock it out once and for all. That's what we're talking about. So it doesn't matter if your mother has a good reason for why you should stop smoking cigarettes. It doesn't matter if your wife has a good reason for why you should stop smoking cigarettes. It doesn't matter if your boss or children or relatives or friends have a good reason for why you should stop smoking or snorting or drinking or shopping or sexing. You have to have a good reason. The reason why you're going to start down the long, lonely road to kicking your addiction, you can't do that unless you have a reason. Leverage. You won't beat your addiction unless you have leverage. You have to have a good reason for why you want to kick your addiction. So, for example, you say, I want to kick my addiction because I want to kick my addiction because when I go to work, I smell like cigarettes or I smell like alcohol and all of my coworkers can hear me. Well, guess what? To me, as a therapist, I don't think that's a good enough reason. I don't think you coming to work smelling like alcohol or cigarettes or cocaine is a good enough reason for your unconscious to join you in the pursuit of kicking your addiction. Does everybody understand what I'm saying? You have to get your unconscious mind, which is the machine of programming. You have to get your unconscious mind on your side. And I don't think your unconscious mind is going to get behind, okay, a reason to drop its addictions because other people don't like how you smell when you come to work. You've been smoking cigarettes for 30 years. You've been smoking cigarettes for 30 years, so your mind doesn't care about a few coworkers who don't pay your bill. A few coworkers that don't pay your bill, your mind, your subconscious doesn't care about what they think about your addiction. I need you to understand that. So you might say, well, Dr. Umar, what's a reason that my subconscious might join me in my pursuit to eliminate my smoking addiction? Well, for example, let's say you love your children very much. You love your children very much, and your children smell daddy smoking, or your children see daddy smoking, and you know that the health outcomes for people who smoke, especially African Americans, are not very good. Esophagus cancer, you can get all types of cancers involved, okay, bronchial asthma, heart attack, okay, a lot of different outcomes. So a reason that may give you leverage, because it's all about what? Emotional power. You need leverage. Emotional power. You cannot kick an addiction unless you have emotional power. And the reason why a lot of us, when we go to the clinic to try to get help, and we go to these phony ass halfway houses, let me say it again, phony ass halfway houses, let me say it again, phony ass halfway houses, the reason why we never kick the addiction is we don't come up with a good enough reason that gives us emotional leverage to bring forth the willpower necessary to kick the addiction. So you need emotional leverage. So getting back to my example, you don't want your children to have esophageal cancer. You don't want your children to die of a heart attack. You don't want your children to die of asthma. So you may say, you know what? I have to kick my smoking. I have to kick my smoking because this is setting a bad example for my children. In fact, my children may already be developing asthma because they're in a house where I'm smoking. So I could be shortening my baby's lifespans based on my smoking habit. Now, that might give you emotional leverage. Does it give you enough? It depends how much you love your children. Does it give you enough? It depends on how important it is that your children grow up without asthma, or that your children never get involved in the same smoking behavior that you get involved in with. So you must have emotional leverage. You're not going to kick an addiction if you only have an intellectual reason. Let me give an example. You say you've done some research, and your research says that 75% of people who smoke will develop throat cancer. Or your reasoning says that 50% of people who smoke will develop bronchoasthma, or 30% of people who smoke will die of a heart attack. Well, guess what? That's an intellectual reason. That's not necessarily, now for some people, it might be emotional if they had a mother or father or relative or someone they live, who they love, who actually smoked and had a heart attack, actually smoked and develop esophageal cancer. So it might be an emotional reason. But what I'm trying to say here is if you only have an intellectual reason to kick your addiction, you're never going to kick your addiction. You cannot only have an intellectual reason. It must be emotion. Emotions drive life. Emotions make us, okay? Think about the best times you had in your life. Okay, the best times you had in your life were tied to an emotion. And if you want to change your life, you're going to have to leverage emotion. We need emotional power, positive emotional power, not negative emotional power. So you come to me with a whole bunch of reasons why smoking is bad that you read out the research journal or the doctor gave you at the hospital. That's not going to do nothing for you because that's intellectual. Okay, 20% of people who smoke may develop esophageal cancer. But then your mind is going to convince you that you're not in the 20%. Your mind is going to convince you that you're in the 80%. Do you see how that works? An addiction will do what it has to do in order to survive. An addiction will do what it has to do in order to survive. An addiction will do what it has to do in order to survive. So if you give your addiction an out, your addiction is going to take it. Now, unless the statistic says 100% of people who smoke will develop cancer. Now, if it said 100% of people who smoke will develop cancer, then your addiction will be trapped. And now your addiction is like, oh my God, we have to do something about this because I'm going to die. But everybody who smokes does not die. Everybody who smokes does not die. So you cannot give yourself an intellectual scientific reason for why you should kick your habit. Why? Because your mind, your addiction, is going to reason that you are part of the population who will not be affected. Facts. 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 Emotional leverage. Okay? You need momentum to change. You gotta have momentum to change. You need leverage and momentum in order to change. Intellectual reasons ain't good enough. Other people's reasons ain't good enough. It must be a reason that has personal meaning. It must be personally meaningful for you. And guess what? And we're gonna talk about this a little later. Until you have a reason to kick your crack or your heroin or your marijuana, and we know marijuana doesn't kill, we even know marijuana does have some positive benefits, but marijuana addiction is still a life destroyer. I'm gonna say it again. Marijuana won't kill you. We know more people die from cigarettes and alcohol than die from cocaine and marijuana every year. We know this. Marijuana won't kill you, but it can destroy your life. Why? Because no addiction is a good addiction. No addiction is a good addiction. I'm going to say it again. No addiction is a good addiction. You addicted to marijuana, you can't work because all you want to do is get high. You addicted to marijuana, you don't spend time with your family because all you want to do is get high. You addicted to marijuana, all you want to do is sleep your life away until it's time to smoke. No addiction is a good addiction. And some of us have marijuana addictions. A lot of black men and women I know are suffering from marijuana addiction, but they don't even know they have it because they keep on what? Their addiction keep on rationalizing its existence. Their addiction keeps on rationalizing its existence by saying, well, marijuana is good. It can open up your third eye. Marijuana is good. It can help you go into another spiritual zone. But that ain't why you smoking. That ain't why you smoking. And we're going to talk a little bit later more about why you are smoking. Okay? So the first law is the law of leverage. Okay? You do have to have intellectual clarity. You do have to know why you're about to take on this addiction. So you must, there is an intellectual component. You have to know why you want to take on this addiction. But what I'm telling you, although you need intellectual clarity in order to fight your addiction, intellectual clarity is not enough. In addition to the intellectual clarity, you must also have emotional leverage. So law number one from Dr. Umar, kicking addictions, is you must have an emotionally meaningful, an emotionally relevant reason for why you need to kick your addiction. And if you don't have an emotionally relevant reason for why you need to kick your addiction, then you probably never will. Okay, I apologize for that interruption. I just had to block Michelle Johnson because she was trolling on my page. I found out on Facebook, if you just touch the comment, the option where you can delete the comment or you can block. So if I catch any trolls, I'm going to block your dusty hotep selves. If you don't like me or my work, why are you on my page? There's millions of Facebook pages. Why are you here? You should be at a Super Bowl party. I'm going to a Super Bowl party right after I'm done this. I got invited to a couple of them, and one of them, I think I'm going to go ahead and check it out. It ain't going to be too much drinking and stuff, just a nice little laid back. Shout out to my Seven Cities families for inviting me to all the different Super Bowl parties today. But I'm going to go to one. So Michelle, and we have the same last name. I hope you're not related to me, okay? But Michelle, you're blocked. So you won't be posting again on my page for the rest of your life. And I hope it was worth it, okay? Because you'll never again post on the page of the most requested black scholar on the planet ever again in the rest of your life because you wanted to be disrespectful, okay? Anyone else want to get blocked? Okay, so I can get back to my lesson. Is that okay? Is it okay if I get back to my lesson? All right. Now, law number two is the law of resolve. Have you ever noticed, have you ever heard the statistic when they say people need to stop smoking 5 times before they kick the habit? Or a woman needs to leave a man 10 times before she gives up an abusive relationship? Or the average cocaine abuser has to stop, they fail 10 times before they finally kick the cocaine habit? Or a heroin user must fail 6 times before they finally kick the habit? That's all nonsense. Do you want to know why I took that sister 10 times to finally leave that guy? Do you want to know why I took the cigarette smoker multiple times before they stopped smoking the cigarettes? Do you want to know why I took the cocaine abuser so many times to relapse, okay, and keep coming back to the cocaine before he or she finally kicked the habit? I'm going to tell you why. It doesn't take 10 times to stop smoking. It doesn't take 20 times to stop drinking. It doesn't take 10 times to stop beating your woman. It don't take 20 times to leave your abusive husband. It doesn't take 20 times to stop spending all your money at the supermarket when you get paid. Excuse me, the clothing market. You know what the problem, you know why I took them 5 times, 10 times, 20 times, 30 times? It's because they did not make up their mind that they wanted to quit. Facts. Let me say it again. It don't take 10 times to stop smoking. It don't take 10 times to stop drinking. It took you 10 times to decide you wanted to stop. Do y'all understand me, family? I need y'all to make sure y'all getting this. Because some of y'all think, well, I tried to stop smoking once. They said it's going to take 4 times, so I got to stop. Try to stop smoking twice. They said it's going to take 4 times, so I got to try to stop smoking a third time. They said it's going to take 4 times, so I got to stop letting my boyfriend beat on me a fourth time. They said it's going to take, you see, it don't take but once. See, what happened was the first 9 times, you didn't make up your mind. The 10th time, you decided to quit. The first 3 times, you didn't make up your mind. The 4th time, you decided to quit. The first 2 times, you didn't make up your mind. The 3rd time, you decided to quit. So the law of resolve says you will keep on relapsing. You will keep on quitting. You will keep on giving up until you make up your mind that you are done. Resolve. I am done. Once you have came to an intellectual, emotional conclusion that I no longer want to be bothered with marijuana or cigarettes or crack or opium or heroin, okay, or Xannies or whatever you into, okay, Percocets, LSD, whatever you into, okay, the weed laced with the cocaine, whatever you into, it only takes 1 time to quit. It didn't take 9 times. It took 9 times because you didn't make up your mind that you wanted to quit. You see that? You were playing with it. You were flirting with the idea of quitting. You didn't make up your mind yet. You made up your mind on the 10th time, and that's why you quit. Why wasn't there an 11th relapse? Why wasn't there a 12th relapse? Why wasn't there a 13th relapse? The reason why you didn't have to go through any more relapses is because you had already made up your mind that last time that you didn't want to do it no more. Had you made up your mind the first time, you wouldn't have had a second, third, or fourth. So that's Dr. Umar Johnson's law of resolve. It only takes 1 time to quit being an addict, but it might take a million times to get to that point. Let me say it again. It only takes 1 time to quit if you're an addict, but it might take you 10, 20, 30 failures before you make up your mind that you want to quit. Facts. Facts. Okay. Now, this is going to sound controversial, but I'm going to say it. Okay. And some psychologists, psychiatrists, counselors, licensed professional counselors, behavior specialists may disagree with me, but that's okay. We can professionally disagree. I have my credentials. I'm not looking to prove anything to nobody, but I've been doing this for 20 years. I've been doing this for 20 years. Y'all ready for my controversial statement? It's not really controversial, but some people might think it is. Do not decide to go to war with your addiction until you have resolved to end the addiction. I don't even want you to start. That's right. I don't even want your husband to start working on his cigarettes. I don't want your wife to start working on her alcohol. I don't want your son to start working on his marijuana. I don't want you to start working on your shopping addiction. I don't want your nephew to start working on his sex addiction. I don't want your little son to start working on his masturbation addiction. And by the way, that is quickly becoming a crisis amongst black boys. The only email and phone call I get more from black mothers than regarding special education and ADHD is masturbation. Not special education, masturbation is quickly becoming one of the main reasons mothers are calling me, because the sons are beating their little junior too often. They're going to choke Billy to death. They're going to beat Billy until he dies. Too much black boy masturbation, because they live in a society that's hypersexual and oversexed, and boys, that's all they just thinking about it. They just want to go and go beat they Billy Bob to death. Beat they Billy Bob to death. Okay? Now, I don't know about most of you brothers out there. Me personally, God is my witness. Supreme consciousness is my witness. I've never masturbated a day in my life. I've never masturbated a day in my life. Okay? And from an African cultural perspective, I do consider it to be deviant behavior. However, in America, I cannot consider masturbation addiction Well, I can consider addiction to be a problem, but in America, I can't consider black boy masturbation to be a major problem because so many Americans masturbate, okay? Black men masturbate, black women masturbate, white men masturbate, white women masturbate, poor people masturbate, rich people masturbate. So since we live in a hypersexual environment, the law of psychology says if it's normal, it may be dysfunctional, it may be maladaptive, but, and it's abnormal, but under white psychology, if more people than not are doing a certain thing, it's now normal. See, normal doesn't mean healthy. Normal from a white perspective doesn't mean, what does normal mean? Well, the tests that we give out, the IQ test, the achievement test, the psychological test, they've all been what? Normed. What do we mean when we say that this psychological assessment has been normed? Do you know what norm means? It simply means to see how many people within a given population would score well on it. It's been normed. Now, they might score low. So you might say this ain't normal because everybody's, yes, it's normal because most people are doing it. So under white psychology and white social science, anything most people are doing is considered normal. So since so many pre-adolescent and adolescent boys, okay, whack their Williams on a regular basis, since so many adolescent and pre-adolescent boys choke their Charlie to death on a regular basis, masturbation, although abnormal from an African context, is not abnormal from a European context. Facts. Facts. Now, I'm not here to debate marijuana addiction. And please don't misquote me. There is use, there is abuse, there is addiction. Let's go through the three states. There is use, there is abuse, there is addiction. Say it with me. There is marijuana use, there is marijuana abuse, and there's marijuana addiction. There is cigarette use, there is cigarette abuse, and there is cigarette addiction. There is cocaine use, there is cocaine abuse, and there's cocaine addiction. Now, if you're a marijuana user, I'm not talking to you. If you are a cigarette user, I'm not talking to you. But if you are an abuser, then I might be talking to you. And if you are addicted, then I am definitely talking to you. So again, if you just a smoker, casual cigarette, casual, you know, six pack, casual marijuana, I'm not talking to you. Y'all need to listen, because a lot of y'all don't listen when people talk, okay? You're so quick to look for criticism that you don't even pay attention to what was said. Use, abuse, addiction. This video is on addiction, okay? So sit down, shut up, and you might learn something, my dusty Hotepper, before I block you on my page. Now, so law number one, let's review. The law of what? Leverage. You must have an emotionally powerful reason for wanting to quit. Law number two, the law of resolve. You must make up your mind that you want to quit. It doesn't take 10 times to stop smoking, sexing, drinking, or whatever else. It only takes one time, but it might take 10 times for you to build up enough willpower to want to finally resolve yourself to commit the addiction. Now, let me give you a little activity for the resolve stage. We're dealing with law two, the law of resolve. You should take out a piece of paper, blank piece of paper, and I want you to write down 25 reasons why kicking your addiction would benefit your life and the people in it. 25 reasons why your addiction, kicking your addiction, would benefit your life and the people in it. 25, okay? And then what I want you to do is I want you to hang that up somewhere in the house where you have to see it. And then I want you to make a copy of it and put the other one in your car or in your pocketbook, because I want you to read it every morning before you go into work. I want you to read it right before you feel a relapse coming on. It might not be strong enough to stop the relapse, but I want to create within you a degree of cognitive dissonance, a degree of guilt. Yes, a degree of guilt for going back to a behavior that you know is not properly serving you as well as people in your family. Now, one thing I think I'm going to do, Dr. Umar Johnson, and y'all can tell me if y'all think this is a good idea. I think I'm going to hold a retreat, a conscious retreat, to deal with brothers and sisters dealing with addictions. What do y'all think about that? A retreat, one just for women with different addictions, a retreat just for men with different addictions, and then a retreat for teenage girls with addictions, okay, and then a retreat for teenage boys with addictions, and then one for elders too, okay? So what do y'all think about that? We're going to do a conscious retreat, okay? We're going to say Hotep to your addictions. That's what we're going to call it. Say Hotep to your addictions, okay? So we're going to work on that. Now, write down your list of 25, hang it up somewhere where you can see it. Now we're going to law number three. Law number three, okay, is the law of relationships. I hope y'all ready to hear this. Y'all ready for this one? This might be a little controversial. Oh, wait, I got to go back. I didn't fully explain why I don't want you to start fighting your addiction unless you have resolve. The reason I don't want you to start fighting your addiction until you have resolved to do so is because you're going to start and stop, and you're going to start and stop, and you're going to prelapse and relapse, and you're going to prelapse and relapse, and you're going to do this so many times, and every time you fail, listen to me well, this is central to understanding addictions. Every time you fail, you train your mind to believe you cannot win. Facts. Let me say it again. This is why I don't want you to start till you're ready. I don't want you to start until you're emotionally leveraged, and I don't want you to start until you have resolve. Because if you say, I'm going to stop smoking these cigarettes, okay? Well, let's say alcohol. You be drinking 20, 40s a day, right? 20, 40s a day, cirrhosis of the liver. I don't want you to start fighting the addiction until you have resolve to end it. Because guess what? Every time you fail, you send a message to your unconscious. Every time you fail to stop drinking that Red Bull, okay, that 40 ounce, that Grey Goose, every time you fail, you program your unconscious to believe you can't win. So what does that mean? That means every subsequent attempt at kicking your addiction is not going to have as much power as the previous attempt, because every time you fail, you convince yourself that you can't win. So I would rather you not even start. I don't even want you to start until you have total emotional leverage and total resolve, so we can kick this addiction once and for all. Facts. Hold on, I think we got another troller. One second. Da, 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 where you at? Hold on, y'all. I saw somebody who I definitely wanna. I gotta find him. I'll find him. I'm gonna get that little Hotepper. But anyway, brothers and sisters, stopping and starting conditions the unconscious that you can't win. Stopping and starting conditions the unconscious that you can't win. So I don't even want you to start until you've made up your mind that you're going to win. One and done. One and done. Did y'all hear me? One and done. A lot of y'all been going, I've been trying to stop smoking 10 years. I've been trying to stop using crack for 20 years. I've been trying to stop cheating on my wife for 30 years. No, you know why? Because you ain't got the willpower. You ain't got no leverage. You done did it so many times that your mind don't even take it serious. How many times you see people go into the halfway house 10, 20 times, come out, do the same thing again? What you going for? Why are you at therapy? Why are you in the rehab program? You ain't made up your mind you want to stop yet. But what you're doing is you're damaging your unconscious will. You're damaging your unconscious ability to support you when you finally make up your mind, because you keep on having these false attempts. False attempts. You know you don't want to stop smoking. False attempts. You know you don't want to get out of that abusive relationship. False attempts. You know you don't want to stop shopping. False attempts. I don't want you to start until you are ready to kick it. Stop programming your mind for failure. I said stop programming your mind for failure. Facts. Law of relationships. Law of relationships. Dr. Umar Johnson's law of relationships for addiction. If you really want to kick your addiction, you're going to have to remove from your life anybody, relatives, friends, lovers, you're going to have to remove anyone from your life who does not support or believe that you can break your addiction. Facts. I have seen so many people try to kick their addictions and fail because they living with, married to, hanging with people who have the same addiction, or people who verbally abuse their attempt to eliminate their addiction, or people who don't support their desire to stop addicting. Did y'all hear what I just said? Let me give an example. Your wife don't want you to stop drinking, because when you drink, you stay at home where she wants you. So she wants you to keep on drinking, because you drinking mean you stay home, which means her relationship is safe. I'm just giving y'all a sick, codependent relationship. Let's talk about codependent relationships since we're dealing with the law. What is codependency? Codependency is sick, and a lot of us are involved in codependent relationships. A codependent relationship is when you are dependent on someone to validate your addiction, and that same person needs you, okay? You need to depend on them to validate your addiction, and they need to depend on you to validate whatever psychological or emotionally dysfunctional lifestyle that they have. Are you understanding what I'm saying? Let me give an example of a codependent relationship. You have a woman with low self-esteem. She has very low self-esteem. She needs constant reassurance from her man. Constant reassurance, right? So her man is a drunk. And whenever he drinks, he don't go to work. Whenever he drinks, he don't hang out. Whenever he drinks, he stay home. So guess what? She keeps telling him that his drinking is not a problem. She keeps telling him that he could keep on drinking. Don't listen to what nobody tell you. You're successful. You got a good job. If your drinking was a problem, you would have been fired by now. So guess what? She's enabling his alcoholism. And by him being home, he's enabling her need to have a man present at all times to validate her womanhood. Codependent, two unhealthy, psychologically and emotionally dysfunctional people who need each other, who absolutely need each other to validate and co-sign and approve of their addictions and other dysfunctional behaviors, and they will join and beat up anybody who tries to come between their relationship. Have you ever seen this? They both sick and they both unhealthy, and if you try to come and tell them that this situation is sick, they will kick your black ass. How many of you have seen this? She co-signing his crack, he co-signing her heroin, leave him alone. He co-signing her marijuana, she co-signing his cigarettes, leave him alone. She co-signing his domestic abuse, he co-signing her low self-esteem, leave him alone. Codependency is the worst relationship on earth, because the other person makes you feel great for not facing your demons. So you're gonna have to get rid of people out of your life. Listen, I've known addicts who had to get a divorce because the spouse was reinforcing the addiction. I know addicts who had to give up their best friends because their best friend was an addict and the best friend wasn't ready to kick the addiction. And that's another point. Sometimes we have group addiction, right? Group addiction. The whole football team addicted to it. You and your whole crew, y'all all smoke crack together. You have a crack pack, P-A-C-T, a crack pack. We got crack pack with five or six smokers. They smoke together. Five or six weed heads, they cipher together. Five or six alcoholics, they get together. Today is the Super Bowl. Today is the Super Bowl. So guess what? There's going to be a lot of alcoholism today. A lot of marijuana today. The Super Bowl today is one of the worst days in America, on the American calendar, for addiction. Let me say it again. The Super Bowl is one of the worst days for addicts, because this is when the cigarette smokers come and the weed smokers come and the overeaters come, right? And what they do, they codependently co-sign each other addiction, and then what do they use as the excuse? They say, don't worry about it, fam. The Super Bowl is only one day out of a year. you can let yourself go. The Super Bowl only one day out of the year. You can smoke today. The Super Bowl is only one day out of the year. You can drink today. The Super Bowl is only one day out of the year. You can smoke your opiate, your PCP, your LSD, your cocaine, your crack. Today is a bad day for addicts. And guess what? One of the worst things you can tell an addict, and I want my addicted population to know, and the only reason why I'm being hard on y'all, because I know y'all can win. Dr. Umar, I know y'all can win. I know y'all can kick y'all addicts. That's the only reason why I'm being like this, because I know your addiction is nothing compared to the willpower that God gave you. Okay? Now, I'm going to take a little lesson out of Alcoholics Anonymous. I don't agree with everything they do, but there's one thing I like that they teach. In Alcoholics Anonymous, they teach that alcoholism is a disease. And I don't necessarily like the disease piece, but what I do appreciate from Alcoholics Anonymous is they teach that you will always be an alcoholic. Once an alcoholic, always an alcoholic. And they teach that, and I don't necessarily agree with the language, but let me get to my point. They teach that because they want you to know that this is a problem that you will always have to manage. This is a problem you will always have to control. This is a problem you will always have to supervise. This is a problem that you will need to stay vigilant against. You know why I like that? Because it doesn't allow you to go bananas on the Super Bowl day. It doesn't allow you to overeat at Thanksgiving. It doesn't allow you to overshop during the Christmas season. See, when you look at their definition of addiction as disease, which I don't totally agree with, but I understand why they say it. Because if they teach you that you will always be an alcoholic, you will never feel that you can drink all you want on Super Bowl and go back tomorrow like it never happened. And psychologically speaking, why can't that happen? Why is it that you can't drink all you want today? So you've been kicking your drinking. You ain't drunk in a month. The Super Bowl is today. You decide to drink like crazy today, or smoke like crazy today, or snort like crazy today, and then tomorrow you go back to work. That's a fallacy. That's an imaginary thing. You know why? Because your brain cannot forget experiences, and every behavior only lays the groundwork for a stronger one tomorrow. So the fact that you pigged out on the Super Bowl, and I hate to say this, but the fact that you went crazy with your drinking and your smoking and your eating on the Super Bowl day, to be honest with you, it almost eliminated all the progress you made for the past 30 days. I know you don't want to hear this, but I got to tell you that. Okay, you've been doing good. No smoking for 30 days. You went crazy on the Super Bowl day, and it eliminated all the progress. You ain't drank for 30 days, and the one day of the Super Bowl, you destroyed all the progress. And do you know why that happened? Do you know why that happened? Because you were still in the process of kicking your addiction. In other words, addiction was still a habit for you. Addiction was still a habit for you. You were weakening it. Because it takes 21 days to what? Create a new habit. You were weakening it, but you didn't totally get rid of it. So the minute you entertained the habit, you see that? You were on a drought, but on the Super Bowl day, you had 18 beers. The minute you wet your unconscious appetite for that alcohol, guess what? You grew the tree all over again. You gave birth to the addiction all over again. You fed the weakness all over again. You fed the addiction all over again. So you can never let up. It's like black people and white supremacy. You can never let up. We let up for Barack Obama. 8 years of Barack Obama, black folks said we're going to take a break. Now, we've been fighting for 400 years, every single president, every day. And soon when a black one get in there, black folks say, I'm going to take a break. And when Obama done, we're going to come right back to where we were in 2008. Are we back where we were in 2008? Hell no. You better try 1708. Guess what? By letting Obama slide for 8 years, you put black people way back 100 years. By letting Obama slide for 8 years, you put black people back 100 years. It's the same thing with addiction. Let your addiction slide for one day. Let your addiction slide for one day. And it's like putting your whole war against your habit back to the first day it started. It's as if you never fought it in the first place. Remember, you never stop fighting until the war is won. You never stop fighting until the war is won. You don't take a timeout for Obama, and you don't take a timeout from smoking or drinking or overeating for the Super Bowl. You are at war, and you must stay vigilant. And that is the law of relationships. Get people out of your life who ain't going to help you. Get people out of your life who are also addicted. You got to get rid of them. How the hell you hanging around addicts and you ain't going to be one no more? How you hanging around overeaters but you don't want to be one no more? How you hanging around marijuana blunt addicts and you don't want to be one no more? You playing games. You cannot keep going back to a situation that provides a trigger for your addiction. You can't keep going back to a situation that provides a trigger for your addiction. Listen, you know why you do that? You ever hear somebody say, I kicked my drinking, but I could go hang with my homies. They're going to be drinking, but I'm okay now. You know what that's what I call? I call that underestimating your addiction and overestimating your willpower. Listen, underestimating your addiction and overestimating your willpower. Let me say it again, because some of y'all might be writing. Underestimating your addiction, okay, and overestimating your willpower. That sows the groundwork for a relapse. That sows the groundwork for a relapse. You said you wasn't going to eat no more pork. You was picking out on pork feet, high blood pressure. You said you ain't eat no pork. You ain't had no pork for a whole year. You ain't had no pork for a whole year. So you say, I can hang around my friends. Now they're going to have that pig feed and the chitlins. And you get around them, and guess what? Your brain has a memory of all the good times you had eating pig feet. Your brain don't get rid of memories. You don't get rid of memories. They're always there. So all those times that you picked out, soon you get around your friends, even though it's been a year later, guess what? Your mind is going to start playing games on you. And guess what? Your friends might even be jealous of the fact that you done made some of, you done lost 100 pounds. Guess what they're going to try to do? Come on and get some of this pig feet, girl. It's only one day. Come on. You work hard. You raise them kids. Your husband going through issues. You keep the family together. You a leader in your community. You have a right to have some fun every once in a while. Ain't that what they tell you? Now they rationalizing weakness. Now they rationalizing your addiction. And you know what you're going to find? When you eat that one piece of pig feet, guess what's going to happen? Not to all of you. Not to all of you. But what's going to happen to most of you? What's going to happen to most of you? Once you eat one piece of pig feet, is that going to be enough for the Super Bowl? That one piece of pig feet at kickoff, is that going to hold you over for the next four quarters? What do y'all think? Is that going to hold on? Hell no. Once you eat that one piece of pig feet, that's going to trigger a memory of all the good pig feet sessions you had, and you're going to start eating more pig feet, and you're going to go home, and you're going to feel guilty, and you're going to feel like ashamed, and you're going to feel like a loser, and the mistake wasn't made eating the pig feet. Eating the pig feet was not the mistake. The mistake was you should have never went back to the environment that triggers the addictive behavior. Don't test yourself like that. Don't test your willpower like that. When you done, you done. You can tell your friends, hey, we can go out to TGI Fridays and we can have something to eat there because they ain't got nothing with pig feet on the menu. Pick a restaurant that ain't got no pig feet, okay? All your friends are smokers, they still your friend. Pick a restaurant where you're not allowed to smoke. That's what you do. You can still hang with your friends, but make sure you create the environment. Don't let them create the environment. An addict never lets other addicts create their environment. Let me say it again. An addict never lets other addicts create their environment. An addict never lets other addicts create their environment. Okay? You need to find people who are going to support you in your resolve to end your addiction. You're going to need to find people who support you in your resolve to, you need positive peer, you need people to say, good job. Good job. You had a bad day. You need people to say, guess what? I believe in you. Sometimes it happens. Let's pray together. Black Jesus, not white Jesus. Let's pray together and you will get right back at it. You need positive peer pressure. You need positive. You don't need negative peer pressure. You ever hear, you ever try to lose weight and you got people in your family say, you ain't going to lose that weight, child. You meant to be big. You ain't going to lose that weight, child. Your grandma was big. Your mama was big. Your grandpapa was big. Why are you trying to lose weight? Ain't nothing wrong with the way you look. They try to work against your decision. You can't be around people like that. You can't be around people like that. And if you related to those people, their influence is greater. If your mother tells you you won't stop smoking, that means a whole lot more than if your coworker said you won't be able to stop smoking. Your mother has psychological leverage in your life. She's your mother. So guess what? Until you kick your addiction, you may have to stay away from your mother because she is conducting psychological warfare. That is psychological warfare. That is psychological warfare. People telling you you won't be able to kick your ass. Psychological warfare is any mental, intellectual, psychological, or emotional message or activity designed to destroy your conviction, your willpower, your leverage, and your momentum, and you don't need that around. You don't need that around. So that was law number three. Now we go to law number four. Law number four is the law of imagination. Imagination is powerful. God gave us imagination for a reason. God gave us imagination for a reason. And I don't think we use our imaginations enough. Imagination is the creation faculty. What does the Bible say? I'm not a Christian, but I respect it. What does the Bible say? First there was the Word, and the Word was made into flesh. First there was the Word, and the Word was made into flesh. We could say first there was the idea. The idea, and the idea was made into flesh. So if you're trying to kick an addiction, I need you every day you wake up, every time you go to the bathroom, every time you're about to have a meal, before you go to sleep, before you make love to your significant other, I need you to imagine yourself free of the addiction. I need you to close your eyes for 5, 10, 15 minutes, and you're going to imagine walking around people who have the addiction you have and not being bothered by it. For 5 minutes, you're going to imagine your life being perfect as it should be without the addiction. Okay? Because one thing that I know, and we believe in this as African people, and when you imagine something, listen to me, I'm giving you science. This is mental. When you imagine something, to imagine something is to make a request of the universe to fulfill it, brothers and sisters. Facts, let me say it again. When you imagine something, it's like writing a letter and mailing it to the universe. An imagination is a request of the invisible powers to produce the thing that is being imagined. Let me say it again. Imagination is a request to the universe to bring forth the thing that is imagined. A thought is a thing, and an imagination is an image filled with requests, filled with things. Put your desires in your imagination. You imagine being accepted by white people. You imagine being loved by white people. You imagine being an American. You imagine being colorblind. Right? You imagine all kind of crazy stuff. How about imagining something that's going to change your life? How about imagine a reality for black people where we're totally independent and self-contained? Facts. Imagine your life without your problems. When you imagine it, your consciousness sends a request to the universe, and the universe begins the preparatory activities to deliver to you that which you wanted. What did Jesus say? Ask and you shall receive. The black Jesus of Ethiopia, the Christ, said, ask and you shall receive. The Bible is cloaked in metaphor. The Quran in metaphor. The Torah in metaphor. The Odu Ifa. The Odu Ifa metaphor. When Christ said, ask and you shall receive, he wasn't saying with the tongue. Ask with the mind. Imagine as you want it. And it will automatically go through the invisible ether. The spirits will pick it up and they will begin the process of delivering to you that which you need. But guess what? The requests will only be answered to the degree of willpower and conviction that was sent along with the imagination request. Did y'all hear what I just said? The universe will only deliver that which you want to the extent that you were committed, convicted, leveraged and filled with willpower when you made the request. Facts. If it is a weak request, there will be a weak response. If it is a moderate request, there will be a moderate response. And if it was a strong request, there will be a strong response. We have to use our imaginations more. That's why we meditate. Facts. The law of imagination is the addict has to see themselves beyond the addiction. They have to see themselves for where they would be after the addiction. That's Dr. Umar's law of imagination. This is mental science. I don't need the white man's books. I don't need Harvard and Yale. I don't need no doctors to tell me nothing. I've learned all they taught me in class, 6 degrees. I know they science, but now I have to take all that, throw it out, and give you the African version. And give you the African version. Psychology is not the study of the mind. Psychology is study of the soul. Psyche is spirit. It is spiritual. Imagine what you want. Send it out every day. Your imagination is a text message to God. It's a text message. And you want to keep on sending out that request to God until God delivers. And when I say God, I'm speaking of the God kingdom. So if it's not delivered by supreme consciousness, it may be delivered by the Holy Ghost. If it ain't delivered by the Holy Ghost, it may be delivered by Orisha Ogun. It may be delivered by Orisha Eshu. It may be delivered by Orisha Oya. It may be delivered by Orisha Ochozi. It may come through Obatala. You understand? It may come through Shango. It may come through Babalu Aye. It may come through Aganyu. It may come through another vessel. Another vessel. It may come through Orisha Oshun. It may come through your ancestors. The God kingdom. In African culture, we don't just deal with God. We deal with God kingdom. It's an empire filled with spirits. This is why I don't understand African spirituality. Because African spirituality deals with the divine empire. It's an empire with all kind of soldiers, ancestors, Orishas, Loas, Obusums, Netters, and the list goes on. The empire strikes back. I said the empire strikes back. Facts. Law number 5. Law of the source. This speaks to the need, and we're only going up to 10. This speaks to the need of the addict to know why they're using this addiction. Why do people become addicts? You become addicts because you have a core problem. You become addicts because you have a serious problem in your life, psychological or practical, that you don't want to address, that's getting the best of you, that's causing you significant sadness, weakness, depression, loss of energy. And instead of facing the problem, you do something else to distract you from the problem. So you go and get the alcohol. You go and get the alcohol. By drinking this, I don't have to think about my blood pressure. By drinking this, I don't have to think about my divorce. By drinking this, I don't have to think about my child abuse. By drinking this, I don't have to worry about being unemployed. By drinking this, so you pick up the alcohol and you drink to do what? Escape. Facing your problem. So whenever there's an addiction, there's a problem being avoided. Let me say it again. Whenever there's an addiction, there's a problem being avoided. Let me say it again. Whenever there is an addiction, shopping, sexing, smoking, drinking, using, whatever it is, whenever there's an addiction, there's a much larger problem that the addictive behavior is serving to distract you from. Facts. The first question I ask an addict, what are you running from? What are you hiding from? What do you feel powerless to overcome in your life? And addiction is the result of repetitive drinking, repetitive drinking, repetitive drinking, repetitive drinking. And why repetitive drinking? Because that problem keeps popping up. And if you have a strong addiction, that means you got a strong problem you're running from. You got a weak addiction, you got a weak problem you're running from. You got a moderate addiction, you got a moderate problem you're running from. What are you running from? Let's face that. If we can crush the cause, we can crush the addiction. If we can crush the cause, we can crush the addiction. This is not alcohol. This is Florida Naturals, Norfolk. All right. I hope this is useful. Is this useful? Okay. Now. Every addiction is the result of different themes in our lives. Okay? I'm going to give you Dr. Umar Johnson's top 8 themes for addiction. The reasons why we drink, the reasons why we smoke, the reasons why we snort, the reasons why we overshop, the reasons why we overeat, the reasons why we oversex, right? Not use, not abuse, addiction. Not use, not abuse. Addiction. These are the 8 themes that I found in my 20 years of work are normally responsible for why people, that problem we're talking about, that central trigger for the addiction, creates in us pain, self-pity, guilt, loneliness, anhedonia, which is loss of pleasure, emptiness, sadness, or depression. Okay? So if you're smoking, drinking, overeating, oversexing, overshopping, oversnorting, whatever it is, you're doing it because you're trying to do what? Wash out, smoke out, eat out, sex out. Your pain, your loss of pleasure, your self-pity, your guilt, your loneliness, your shame, your emptiness, your sadness, your facts. Self-pity. My life should be better. Let me drink. Anhedonia. Nothing is fun anymore. Let me drink. Guilt. I can't believe that I'm the reason my brother in jail. Drink. Sadness. I don't want to live. Drink. Loneliness. I don't have nobody that loves me. Drink. Y'all follow me? You follow me, right? So it's normally one of those things. So that's the emotion. Remember how I said you need emotional leverage to kick an addiction? The addiction was created by negative emotional leverage. So now you need positive emotional leverage to kick it. Your addiction has emotional leverage. It's doing what? You think it's saving you from your shame, your guilt, your pain, your depression, your sadness. It has emotional leverage. You got to do what? Come up with positive emotional leverage to combat the negative emotional. The addiction is the result of negative emotional leverage. Now you need positive emotional leverage in order to combat it. Facts. Know why you are abusing. Know the source of the addiction, not the Band-Aid. What did Nat Turner say? Reverend Nat Turner said, don't strike at the branch, strike at the root. Don't give me the symptoms of your problem. Tell me what the core problem is. Okay? Well, I feel lonely. How you feel lonely? You married. My husband ain't spending time with me. Why your husband ain't spending time with you? You understand? Trace it down to the root. Your marital dysfunction, is that the root or is it something deeper than that? Maybe your father wasn't in your life. You never been validated and your husband ain't doing a good job of validating you. So it's not really your husband. It's the lack of the father's validation you needed as a child that you have interpreted to mean that you cannot be as good of a woman or you're not as worthy as another woman because your father wasn't there and you've interpreted the absence of your father from your life as indicative that you are worthless. Is that the true problem? Take it to the root. Take it to the root. Not the symptoms, the root. I don't like my job. And then I talk to you about your job and I find out the job ain't the problem. I find out that it's really the family. You ain't got nobody to come home to when you leave the job. And then when we look at the family, we end up finding out that there was some sexual molestation by somebody in the family that got covered up. And then that's the root. It was the abuse. Take it to the root, not the branch. Take it to the root. Facts. I hope this is useful for my brothers and sisters suffering from addictions. Okay, we got 5 more. 5 down, 5 more. Super Bowl kicks off in an hour, so I'm going to try to be done in the next 30 minutes so I can get on over to my Super Bowl party. Okay, my Virginia family, I ain't seen them in a while. They got some shrimps. Okay, they got some salmon, some sea bass. You feel me? Nice little Hotep vegan ginger ale. Don't get me to lying. It's going to be Seagram's, but I'm cutting back, though. I kicked the meat in 2016, so 2017, I got to kick something else with the meat. I don't know if it's going to be my ginger ale. I don't know if it's going to be my Häagen-Dazs. Y'all know I can't live without my pineapple coconut or my cherry vanilla Häagen-Dazs. So I got to give up ginger ale or Häagen-Dazs. And I don't, that's, see, I'm going through the withdrawals. The withdrawal. Let's talk about, there was a psychologist, two psychologists, by the name of Dr. Freeman and Dr. Dolan. I happen to know Dr. Freeman. He was one of the professors at the college where I earned my doctorate degree. I'm not a big fan of his because he was a racist. He used to say racist things about African Americans in class, and I've had to check him a couple times, so I'm not a big fan. But he was a very intelligent guy. And they came up with a theory called stages of change. They came up with a theory known as stages of change. And I want to quickly go through the Freeman and Dolan model. This is not my model, this is theirs, but I find it very applicable when you're dealing with addictions. Okay. There's 10 stages in the stages of change, according to this model. Okay, 10 stages. The first stage, and I need my addicted people to listen, but this is good for everybody because it helps you in your life when you have to get things done and you haven't made up your mind yet. So the first stage of addictions or stages of change, excuse me, is non-contemplation. This is somebody who has a problem, and in our case, an addiction. They don't even want to start thinking about doing something about the problem. Did y'all hear what I said? I'm going to say it real slow. They don't want to think about doing something about the problem. They don't want to think about doing. So they are anti-thinking about the problem. Did y'all follow that? It's called non-contemplation. We was trained on this. They're not even thinking about doing something about the problem. Okay? And then second, you have anti-contemplation. This is when you're thinking about it, but your thinking is, I don't want to do nothing about it. You're anti-thinking. I don't want to think about the problem. So first, you ain't thinking about it. And then next, you thinking about not thinking about it. You understand me? I don't want to think about doing something about my smoking. I don't want to think about doing something about my overeating. I don't want to think about doing something about my weight loss. So you got non-contemplation, anti-contemplation, then there's pre-contemplation. So, for example, you watch Dr. Umar Johnson's video tonight on addiction. You say, Dr. Umar says some things. He got me thinking about doing something. Now you at pre. It's still pre because you ain't done nothing yet. It's just pre. It's like the Hotep community, right? The Hotep community, the black conscious community, is nothing but what, y'all? Contemplation. It's all thought. They thinking about doing something for black folks. But they ain't did shit yet. They just thinking about doing something for black, right? The Hoteppers, they thinking about doing something for black folks, but ain't done nothing, right? So you're there, pre-contemplation. You're starting to thinking about doing something. And then stage four, contemplation. Now you're thinking about doing something about your problem. Then stage five is action planning. Action planning. Now you're going to start getting serious about this. Let me put a program on paper. I want to give up this sugar addiction, this type 2 diabetes. I want to get rid of this. I'm going to give up these salty foods, this high blood pressure. I'm going to get rid of this. I'm going to stop smoking these cigarettes. I'm giving up crack once and for all. I'm going to get my family back. I'm giving up this heroin. You understand? I'm giving up this PCP, these Lace J's, this cocaine mixed with weed. I'm giving up the candy apple blunts. I'm giving up the cherry vanilla blunts. I'm giving it up, right? You think. You got the action plan. That's stage five. Then stage six is action. Action. You finally put your plan in action. But you notice there was five stages before action. There were five stages before action. It takes a while to get there. Conscious community is still at pre-contemplation, contemplation. They ain't doing no action plan. It's all intellectual masturbation, right? So now you got action and then stage seven. What's stage seven? Prelapse. I need y'all to catch me. What is prelapse? Not relapse, prelapse. What is prelapse? Prelapse is when you start thinking about giving up your war against your addiction. You prelapse, and it's mental. You prelapse. You're like, this is good and all, but I miss my cigarettes. This is good and all, but I miss my pig feet. This is good and all, but I miss all those women I had, you know, on the side with my wife. I like losing this weight, but in order to lose this weight, I gave up a lot of things. You start rationalizing. You start reminiscing. That's why you got to control your mind. That's one of my laws. You got to control your mind when you're trying to kick an addiction. So prelapse is when you start thinking about what? Quit. You're like, this ain't that bad. People drink all the time. It ain't that bad. Like, can I just get a little bit? You see, you prelapse. You start laying the foundation for a justification of going back to the addicted behavior. You start laying the foundation for justification of going back to the addicted behavior. And then what comes right after prelapse? Stage 8, relapse. After prelapse is relapse. You see that? You thought about it. Once you thought about it, that's the trigger. The thought is the trigger because thoughts are things. That's the trigger. You prelapse. If you're going to prelapse, you're going to relapse. You start thinking about cheating on your wife again, you're going to cheat on your wife again. You start thinking about drinking alcohol, you're going to drink alcohol. You start thinking about eating them pig's feet, you're going to eat the pig feet because you're creating a mental context. You are imagining. See, you're using your imagination. You're imagining the pig feet. You're imagining the sex. You're imagining the sin. Remember I said the law of imagination. You're supposed to imagine yourself free of the addiction. But instead, you are imagining yourself with the addiction. That's not good. That's not good. Okay? So though, and then you have maintenance, which is stage 10. Maintenance is when you get back on focus, you're back on task, you're back on track, and you're moving forward. That's the maintenance, okay? So now we go to law number 6. Law number 6 is the law of replacement. And our parents need to listen to this. Our parents, because when we deal with behavior modification for children, what do I always say? If you got to come up with a replacement behavior that still allows the child to get the need met. If he can't crack jokes in class, maybe he can go up to the front of the board and clean off the erasers, and that still allows him to get the attention he needs from his classmates. So a replacement behavior is an acceptable way, an acceptable and constructive way to still get your need met, but you're going to get your need met in an appropriate way versus a dysfunctional way. Does everybody understand? So if somebody say you want to give up smoking, okay. Until we've kicked your habit and until we've dealt with the problem that caused it. Did y'all hear what I just said? What did I just say? I said, until we kick your habit and until we get rid of the problem that caused it. I want to say this again. Until we kick your habit and until we get rid of the problem that caused it. Because if we don't get rid of the problem that caused it, either the addiction will come back or you will replace it with another kind. Did y'all hear that? First it was cigarettes, now it's alcohol. Now it's crack. You understand? So if we don't deal with the cause, the root, if we don't pull the root out, then that addiction will get worse or you will replace it with something else. My lips are a little dry. Hold on. Okay, now. Smoking gives you a lot of pleasure. Smoking gives you a lot of pleasure. So until we kick the addiction and eliminate the cause of the smoking, what are you going to do when you feel the urge to smoke? Now you might say, you know what I'm going to do, Doc? Whenever I feel the urge to smoke, I'm going to go outside and I'm going to run 10 miles. Your ass ain't going to run no 10 miles because you out of shape. Your ass ain't ran 1 mile since high school. So why are you sitting up here playing me, talking about you going to run 10 miles whenever you find an urge to smoke? Your ass ain't running. And you know why you ain't going to run? Even if you could run 10 miles, you're not going to run 10 miles. You want to know why? Because running isn't pleasurable for you. You don't get pleasure from running. You got pleasure from smoking. So if we're going to create a replacement behavior, it got to make you feel almost as good as the smoking. Running, you don't like running. So why is running your replacement behavior? Don't play me. Play yourself. Don't play me. Play yourself. Now you might say, Doc, I really love playing pool. I used to be on the pool team. Me and my father play. I love pool. I really love pool. I would rather play pool than watch the Super Bowl. Then I say, you know what? Pool might work. Because from what I'm hearing you say, playing pool gives you enough powerful, positive energy that it can distract you from the smoking or the drinking or the snorting or the sexing or the overeating. So guess what? That means, though, if pool is going to be your replacement behavior, if playing pool is going to be your replacement behavior, where is the closest pool table? Do you have one in your house? Do you need somebody to play pool with you? Because if you play alone, that's fine. But let's say half of your fun is competing with someone else. That means you got to have people on demand who you can call up, okay, and say, yo, I'm getting that craving, brother. Can we go shoot about an hour, bro? And he said, yes, I'm going to meet you there. Let's go. Okay? And then where is the pool hall? Is the pool hall close enough? See, it got to be convenient. Because smoking is convenient. Your cigarettes is right there. Your alcohol is right there. Your cocaine is right there. So if we're going to use pool as the replacement behavior for your addiction, if we're going to use pool as the replacement behavior for your addiction, then it must be convenient for you to access that replacement activity. Does everybody understand? The replacement activity, the activity that you're going to do in place of the addiction, must be as convenient as the addiction. It must be as convenient as the addiction. If you want to smoke some crack, you can go right down to the street and get the crack man, right? It's convenient, crack man. All you got to do is say crack. Here he come, right? With a nickel bag of crack for you. So your replacement has to also be convenient. Now, if you like the workout, if you really like the workout, that might be replaced. But it got to be something you like. It's all about you. It got to be something you like. Now, here's the thing. Whatever the replacement behavior is going to be, because we're switching out alcohol, you say, you know what I'm going to start doing? Instead of playing alcohol, I'm going to play my video game. I'm going to get on my iPad, and I'm going to start playing my video games, okay? If video game playing is strong enough, if the video game plan is strong enough to drown out the urge to drink, use it. But video gaming can become an addiction too. Video gaming can become an addiction too. So you got to be careful with your replacement behavior so you don't end up causing another addiction. Example, I knew of a sister. She was on crack, cocaine, bad. She liked to eat. So guess what she did? She was beautiful. You know, had that Dr. Papa body, the whole nine, right? So her replacement behavior for snorting cocaine was to go home and cook. And she was a good cook. But guess what happened? By using food, which can be an addiction, as her replacement for crack, she went from 140 pounds to 440 pounds. And now we have to get her off of the food addiction, which she used to get off the crack addiction. Do y'all see what I'm talking about? Try to let your replacement behavior be healthy, and you must make a contract with yourself. You must promise yourself that you're going to do this replacement behavior each and every time that you get a craving to participate in the addictive behavior. If you don't have a strong replacement, if you don't have an alternative activity that you can engage in that is just as emotionally satisfying as the addictive behavior, you will lose. You will lose. Your replacement behavior has to be as strong as the addictive behavior, or you will lose. Remember, how did you get addicted in the first place? Because you're drowning out problems. You're looking for peace of mind, right? So whatever you replace this with, playing video games, if you're going to replace this with the video games, okay, then guess what? You got to really, the video game plan must be as emotionally satisfying as the alcohol, or it ain't going to work. Because you started drinking to drown out guilt and shame and loneliness and self-pity and depression. So the video game plan has to be equal to the addictive behavior, or this will come back and push that out the way. Is everybody clear? Is everybody clear? Okay. So, the other thing too, triggers. We talked about this in an earlier law, but with the law replacement, watch your triggers and your context clues. What do I mean? I'm an overeater, hypothetically, right? Soon I walk into a house, I smell food. My stomach says, you gotta eat. I smell food, stomach say you got to eat. So guess what? I got to limit the amount of places I walk in where I can smell a strong, good smell of food, right? You a cigarette smoker, right? Even if you see a pack of cigarettes, you go crazy. So guess what? When you go to the store, the shop, you ain't going to go nowhere near the cigarette counter. Control the environment, because all of those things serve as triggers for an addiction. You want to suffocate your addiction. You don't want to feed it. Why would you feed an alcohol addiction bottles of alcohol? Why would you feed an overeating addiction fresh smells everywhere? Why would you feed a cigarette addiction the visual image of sin? Don't underestimate your addiction and don't overestimate your willpower. I said it before. Remember that. Don't underestimate your addiction and don't overestimate your willpower. So that's the law of replacement. Now, number seven is the law of elimination. You know what this means? This means therapy or whatever we got to do to deal with the problem. Find the root. Molestation, low self-esteem, dysfunctional marriage, trauma. Find the root and let's get you some help. Let's get you some professional therapy, some professional help. I'm going to give you out a number to the Association of Black Psychologists, but I also need you to know that you could call on Association of Black Counselors, Association of Black Social Workers. You could call on behavior specialists. There's a lot of mental, marriage and family therapists. Treat the problem that's causing the addiction. That's the Dr. Umar Johnson law of elimination. You must treat the problem that's causing the addiction. Does everybody understand? If you don't treat the problem, you're just going to keep switching out addictions your whole life. Treat the problem. We got to treat the problem. And this is my problem with halfway houses in addiction program. They treat the addiction. They don't treat the problem. Let me give you an example. You got 10 men. They are all crack addicts. 10 brothers. They're all crack addicts. But guess what? The reason why they are crack addicts is different. He a crack addict because he saw his father get murdered. God forbid. He a crack addict. He was a victim of child sexual abuse. He a crack addict. His parents got divorced. He a crack addict. His mom never spent no time with him. He a crack addict. His wife just uses and abuses him. He a crack addict. He don't get to see his kids. He a crack addict. He just lost a good job. They all on crack, but there's 10 different reasons, and each one of them needs their own individual addiction plan, okay? Treat the addiction so we can kill it. Treat the problem that causes the addiction. That's my law of elimination. That's my law of elimination. And guess what? Law of elimination says you got to have your own what? Behavior modification program. Every time you have a good week, you should reward yourself. You didn't do no overeating, reward yourself. You didn't smoke this week, reward yourself. You didn't snort this week, reward yourself. No blunts this week, reward yourself. I like to go to the movies. Dr. Umar Johnson, you catch me in the movie theater by myself, right? I'm going to go to the movies tonight after the Super Bowl right here in Norfolk because I want to see The Rings because I'm a horror guy. I like the suspense movies, right? So I would reward myself with movies because I like movies, so I can do that. You might not like movies. You got to reward yourself by... I was about to say go to Atlantic City. You can't do that because then you'd be gambling. That's another big addiction, gambling. Gambling, right? And how do they get the gamblers? The gambling addiction. How do they get the gamblers? They get the gamblers because they feed you an imagination of what your life would be like if you won this $1 million. Remember how I talked about the law of imagination? They use the law of imagination when you gamble. The Super Bowl is coming on. People are gambling for the Super Bowl. Some people are going to lose their houses. They're going to lose their whole life savings. They're going to lose all their investments on the Super Bowl. Why do people gamble? Because the imagination. Gambling taps into the law of imagination, and it makes you imagine all the things you can do if you can get this $1 million. Now, you know you need that money to pay your rent. You know you need that money to pay your rent. That's your logical mind. That's your logical mind. Your logical mind says you need this $1,000 to pay your rent. That's the logical mind. But then the law of imagination comes in, okay? Your super consciousness. Imagination is related to the super consciousness. So they tap into your super consciousness and you start thinking about Mercedes-Benz and a new house and getting out of the hood. Da, 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 da. And what wins out? The rational mind that says pay your rent or the super conscious mind of the imagination that says bet it on the Super Bowl. And you lose and now you worse off than you was before because they tapped into your imagination and your imagination is very powerful. Too often the imagination of black men and women is used against us. We need to start using the imagination of black men and women to help us. To help us. Okay? So So that's the law. And if you had a bad week, you got to punish yourself. You say, you know what? I was going to go hang out with the boys this weekend. I can't. I smoked one pack of too many cigarettes. And I said that if I don't meet my goal, I can't go hang out with the fellas. Ladies, you know what's a good punishment for women? You can't get your hair done. That's right. You overate this week, no hair. That's right. You had one more extra can of beer than you were supposed to, sister. No nails. Okay? Find things that you know matter to you. They got to matter to you, because if they don't matter to you, they're worthless. That's what's wrong with black parents. Y'all keep talking about y'all can't change y'all kids' behavior because y'all don't use consequences that matter. Well, I took his phone. He don't care about your phone. He got a damn tablet. What do you need a phone for? He can still play with it on the tablet. The consequences have to matter to you. They have to matter to your children. You have to put yourself on your own behavior modification program, which is just a fancy word for saying you need consequences and you need rewards for when you do well and don't do well, with managing and reducing your dependence on your addictive behavior. Facts. Okay? And then we go to law number 8, right? And law number 8 is the law of thought control. Control your thinking. Don't let people put things in your mind that's going to weaken your willpower, your resolve, and your emotional leverage. Okay, don't daydream about how life was when you was cheating on your wife. Don't daydream about how life was when you was eating the pig feet. Don't start daydreaming. Daydreaming will set you up for a relapse. Daydreaming will set, no daydreaming about how you were under the, we're trying to kill it. Don't feed it. See, you're feeding the addiction. Oh man, I remember how good I used to smoke a pack of Newports right after work. And why are you feeding? No thought control. Okay, this is the law of thought control. Law number 8, control your thoughts. Because if you don't, then your thoughts will go right back to that addiction and you will start engaging in the addictive behavior again. No daydreaming, no self-doubt, no exposure to the trigger. Okay? Don't reinforce your brain with thoughts about the addictive behavior. Stay focused. Commercial come on, turn the channel. Commercial come on about alcohol, turn the channel. Commercial come on about cigarettes, turn the channel. You watching a movie, and in the movie they getting high. Turn the channel. Don't wake up your addiction. You haven't killed it yet. Your addiction is not you. It's another person. Did you hear me? The way you're going to have to fight this thing, it's not you. It's something living inside of you that don't belong in you, that you need to get out of you. That's how you personify and conceptualize your addiction. Let me say it again. It is not you. It don't belong in you, but it is in you. It has taken over you, and you have to give it its eviction papers. Facts. Law number 9 is the law of relapse. When you start doubting yourself, questioning yourself, and what's the number one question that lays the ground for relapse? Is it worth it? You prelapse before you relapse, right? You prelapse before you relapse. You start thinking about drinking. You start thinking about smoking. You start thinking about cheating. You start thinking about gambling, going to AC, gambling on the Super Bowl. You start thinking about shopping again. And guess what? That thinking about wakes up the imagination, and you start imagining stuff, and the next thing you know, you didn't engage in it. Remember, there is no relapse without prelapse. There is no relapse unless you thought about it first through prelapse. No relapse without prelapse. Okay? You don't fail unless you think about thought precedes behavior. Thought precedes behavior. Thought precedes... Dr. Umar, I tried to stop smoking, brother, and I relapsed. Okay, what were the thoughts that triggered the relapse? What do you mean? It just happened. I just know it did not just happen. You may not have been conscious of it, but you were already thinking about going back to the bottle. You were thinking about cheating on your wife. You were thinking about gambling. You were thinking about overeating. Yes. So what were the thoughts that you entertained from the devil And by devil, I'm conceptualizing that as any thoughts that are contrary to the life you want to live is the devil. Let me say it again. Any thoughts that run contrary to the life you want to live is the devil. Let me say it again. Any thoughts that run contrary to the way you want to live is the devil. It's not you. It don't belong in you. It's living in you. It's taking over you. And it's time for you to kick it out of your body and out of your life. The devil. Get rid of it. Black people have post-traumatic slavery disease. We got the devil living in us. Black men and women got the devil living in us. It's time for us to exorcise the devil. Kick his ass out of our bodies. Kick him out of our mind as a pretext to kicking him out of our life. Facts. Stop negotiating with failure. Well, maybe I could smoke a little bit. Maybe one blunt. Maybe some pick feet. Stop negotiating with failure. That's why you need emotional leverage. So you do not negotiate with failure. Stop underestimating the addiction and overestimating your willpower. Y'all ready for the last one? The last law. The last law. So let's recap them. The law of leverage. You got to have a strong emotional reason for why you want to quit. The law of resolve. It don't take a million times to quit smoking. It only takes one time, but it might take you a million times to make up your mind you want to quit. Number three, the law of relationships. You got to get rid of people who are not going to support your desire to eliminate your addiction once and for all. Be conscious of what? Codependent relationships. Be conscious of other people around you who have the same addiction, who are not as ready and prepared and resolved and motivated as you are to eliminate their addiction. Law number four, law of imagination. You should visualize and imagineize yourself free of the addictive behavior. See success so you can achieve success, because every imagination is a what? Every imagination is a request letter to the universe to deliver that thing which you want, but the universe will only deliver it with the same power as it was sent, right? Weak request from God, weak response from God. Strong request from God, strong response from God. But the request includes what? The willpower, conviction, determination, and dedication with which the request was sent. You can't say, God, help me lose weight, God, please. God ain't gonna help you. Are you trying to do something to lose the weight? Are you serious about losing the weight? Are you dedicated about losing the weight? Do you have emotional leverage to lose the weight? Okay? Ask and you shall receive. Ask and you shall receive. Okay? As a man thinketh, so is he. The next law is law of the source. We got to do what? Know why we are addicted in the first place. What is the cause of the addiction? What is the cause of the addiction, right? That's the eight themes. Okay? Is it guilt? Is it loneliness? Is it pain? Is it self-pity? Is it anhedonia? Is it shame? Is it emptiness? Is it sadness? Is it depression? Know why you have an addiction. What are you running from? What are you running from that you're trying to drown out, smoke out, eat out, sex out, right? And then we go to the next law, which is law number six, the law of replacement. What are you going to do when you're not doing the addicted? You love drinking. So you need something else you can do to take your attention off that drinking. And if that replacement behavior ain't strong enough, you ain't gonna never stop drinking. And then your law number seven is the law of elimination, okay? That means you don't go around anything that triggers that addiction. You don't be around nobody that triggers that addiction. You reward yourself for staying away from the addiction, and you punish yourself whenever you have a prelapse or a relapse, okay? And then the law number eight, thought control. Control what goes on in your mind. Don't allow yourself any mental triggers to bring back that addiction, because the addiction hasn't been killed yet. Law number nine is the law of relapse. You cannot relapse unless you thought about it. Prelapse, okay, precedes relapse. Prelapse precedes relapse. If you don't think about failing, you won't fail. If you don't think about failing, you won't fail. But once you start thinking about it, what are you doing? You're creating a context that allows for it to happen. And now we go to law number 10. Last and final law, so y'all can get to the Super Bowl and I can get to my Virginia party. They better have some Virginia seafood, okay? It's 6 o'clock, so we made good time. Y'all got 30 minutes. Remember, no addictions tonight. My smokers, don't use the Super Bowl as an excuse. My drinkers, don't use the Super Bowl as an excuse. What did I say earlier? If you drink that 40, you're going to undo all the work you did. Why? Because that drinking you're going to do tonight is going to trigger all those memories of all the drinking times you didn't have before. And it's going to undermine your willpower, your emotional leverage, your commitment, and your resolve. Don't do it. That means what? You might got to watch the Super Bowl at home. You're either going to have to ask them to get rid of all the cigarettes, or ask them to get rid of all the weed, or ask them to get rid of all the alcohol, or ask them to get rid of all the cocaine. Okay? You're going to have to ask them to clean that place out, or you can't go. You may have to stay home and watch it. You may have to stay home and watch the Super Bowl. Okay? Don't negotiate with failure. Going to that Super Bowl party, where the substance of your addiction will be, you're negotiating with failure, you won't win. You're underestimating the addiction, and you're overestimating your willpower. That's never good. Law number 10, last and final law, is the law of the devil. The law of the devil. The law of the devil. What is the law of the devil? The law of the devil says that in order to kick an addiction, you're going to have to go through hell. You're going to have to stare the devil in the face, black man and black woman. But guess what? If you slay the devil, you will meet God as soon as you walk out that door. If you slay the devil, you will meet God as soon as you walk out that door. You cannot get to God unless you go through the devil. Black people cannot get to freedom unless they go through the white man. Ain't no way around it. You got to go through the white man to get to your freedom. And if you want to be free from your addictions, if you want to meet God in the peace that transcends all understanding, you got to face your devil. Is your devil alcohol? Is your devil cigarettes? Is your devil oral sex? Is your devil masturbation? Is your devil expensive, conspicuous consumption? Are you a shopaholic? Is that your devil? Is your devil expensive food? What is your devil? Slay that damn devil. Don't let the devil get the best of you. Don't let the devil make you think that you can't win. That's why I say don't start fighting the addiction until you made up your mind that you're going to kick the addiction. Because if you try to fight the addiction before you made up your mind that you're going to kick the addiction, you're going to keep on losing and relapsing and prelapsing. And you, in the process, you're training your unconscious that you can never win. God is on the other side of that door. But to get to God, you got to go through the devil. Brothers and sisters, I want to thank you all for tuning in today. I hope this was beneficial. Please tell me if it was. If you have ideas for other video tutorials, seminars that I need to do that are within my expertise, prerogative, and interest, please text it or email it. Say, Doc, you need to do a video on this. Or, Doc, I think you should do a video on this. Or, Doc, you touched on this, but you never really went into it. Please let me know. I want to use my expensive education to benefit my people for free if I can. Okay, so please let me know. Good luck with the Super Bowl tonight. Hopefully everybody will be in a safe place, a safe place. Don't go to no crazy places where there could be any crime, anything like that. You know, black folks hate each other, and we don't need none of you serving as triggers for violence against you or anyone else. Norfolk, I can't wait to see Norfolk State tomorrow. All the brothers and sisters there, the students, seven cities come on out, Hampton and Suffolk and Chesapeake and Norfolk and Newport News and Virginia Beach. I hope to see all of you guys in Norfolk State tomorrow. The doors open up at 5:30, I believe. Doors open up at 5:30. No, doors open up at 5. Doors open up at 5. And the program starts at 6. Doors open up at 5. And the program starts at 6. Maybe a little later. I expect to be speaking until approximately 8 o'clock. I expect to be speaking roughly between 6 and 8, and I'll be signing books after that. As I said, I also have some I Am That Turner hoodies, the first time that those hoodies are in the state of Virginia. So please come on out, show love. The event is free. You do not have to be a college student. My very next event will be in Richmond, Virginia. I will be in Richmond next Wednesday. The 15th, Richmond, Virginia. And if you need the flyer for that, you can email me, drumarjohnson.com or drumarjohnson@yahoo.com, or you can text my cell, 215-989-9858, 215-989-9858, or you can call the toll-free number, 844-4-DR-UMAR, 844-4-DR-UMAR, that's 844-4-DRUMAR. And when I look at the other upcoming events that we have, okay, we have Norfolk tomorrow, Richmond next Wednesday the 15th, Atlantic City, New Jersey. Dr. Umar Johnson will be in Atlantic City, New Jersey Atlantic City, New Jersey, South Jersey in the building. I will be in Atlantic City for the very first time. Atlantic City for the very first time. I've never spoken in Atlantic City, and that will be on Friday, February the 17th. Doors open up at 4. Power lecture from 6 to 8. Book signing 8 to 10. Atlantic City, Camden, New Jersey. Okay, all the South Jersey cities, please come on out to show love. And then I will be in Wilmington, Delaware. Wilmington, Delaware. My first indoor power lecture in Wilmington in about 4 years. Of course, I was there for the Stop the Violence rally outside. But this is my first formal power lecture in Wilmington, Delaware in several years. That's Saturday the 18th at the Police Athletic League, 3 o'clock. And then I'll be in North Jersey. So we got South Jersey Friday, North Jersey Sunday. South Jersey, Atlantic City on Friday the 15th of February. And then we have North Jersey, Newark, New Jersey on Sunday the 19th. North Jersey, Newark, New Jersey, Brick City, Whitney Houston, Shaquille O'Neal, Red Man, Stand Up. Prince of Pan-Africanism will be in Newark, New Jersey on Sunday, February the 19th. Morgan State. I will be in Morgan State, Morgan State University, Baltimore. My first time in Morgan, February the 22nd. Chicago. Shout out to Chi-Town, Chi-Rac. We're going to work it out. Prince of Pan-Africanism will be back in Chicago, Illinois, the place where my rise to be king of the conscious community began. And I will be in Chicago on February the 22nd. And then Indianapolis, Indiana. I haven't been to Indianapolis in 2 years. Indianapolis, Indiana at the Jewel Center on the 27th. I believe that's Monday the 27th. And then we're going to go to the town of Heavy D and Puff Daddy, and that's Money Earning Mount Vernon on the 28th. So we got Indianapolis on the 27th. Indianapolis, Indiana on the 27th. And then we got Money Earning Mount Vernon, New York. My first visit in over 5 years to Money Earning Mount Vernon. That will be on the 28th. And then Paterson, New Jersey on March the 1st. Shout out to Paterson, New Jersey. I was just watching Reuben Hurricane Carter's story on the TV today. I forgot that Reuben Hurricane Carter, and I'm not sure if he's still with us or not, but Reuben Hurricane Carter from Paterson, New Jersey. So I'll be in Paterson for the Fred Jordan Memorial Scholarship March the 1st. Sacramento, California. Sacramento, California. Sacramento, California. On March the 4th, Bridgeport, Connecticut, March the 22nd, Bridgeport, Connecticut, Arizona State, March the 27th, Arizona State, March the 27th. And then shout out to the Africans in Hong Kong, Beijing, Bangkok. I will be in China for a week-long tour of China. Yes, there's black people in China. There's lots of black people in China. Africans from America deployed through the U.S. military services, also African immigrants from the continent, also the indigenous Africans who went into Asia from Africa and settled Asia. Yes, there's millions of black people in Asia, and they're coming to see Dr. Umar for my China tour, which will be from May 13th to the 21st. I'll be in Washington, D.C. for Power Talk on June the 24th. Again, Washington, D.C., Power Talk June the 24th, and then the Black College and Consciousness Tour out of Atlanta will be June the 28th to July the 12th, and then we're going to Africa for the two-week tour, July the 20th to August the 3rd, and I'm still working on the dates for the Repatriation Task Force, brothers and sisters. So, with that being said, I want to say thank you for tuning in to the Prince of Pan-Africanism. I love y'all. The support y'all give me, please buy tickets, even if you ain't coming. Buy some tickets to donate to the cause. Buy some tickets to donate to the cause. Go to GoFundMe.com/Dr. Umar. Go to GoFundMe.com/Dr. Umar. Get your tickets for the events. If you don't see the tickets on Eventbrite, it's because I'm not the host. You won't see tickets for Norfolk. You won't see tickets for Morgan. You won't see tickets for Mount Vernon because I'm not the host. But if you need the flyer, you can text me for the flyers, 215-989-9858. If you need those flyers, or you can email me, DrUmarJohnson@Yahoo. Don't forget, every Tuesday morning, we got the Black Parent Teleconference. Every Tuesday morning, we got the Black Parent Teleconference, 857-232-0158. 857-232-0158. And the access code is 870-864-POUND. 870-864-POUND is the access code. If you need to mail in your donation, payable to FDMG Academy, P.O. Box 6872, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, 19132. Again, FDMG Academy, P.O. Box 6872, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, 19132. And the only thing I need to say after that, Atlanta, I'm riding with y'all tonight. Falcons, take the Super Bowl. I can't stand the Patriots. All white Jesus, Tom Brady. Let's get that Super Bowl to Atlanta. And who knows, we might get that FDMG in Atlanta too. One God, one name, one destiny. Gangsta Garveyism signing out. Prince of Pan-Africanism, most requested scholar. Don't hate because you ain't me. Okay? Is Pan-Africanism a perish? Is unify or die? Go Hawks.